College Place is a video library of noteworthy presentations, panel discussions, and lectures featuring guest speakers and faculty members, taped at one of the Milwaukee Area Technical College's 4 southeastern Wisconsin campuses. These are produced by students in the college's associate's degree program in television video production in coordination with Milwaukee Public Television.
So to begin the discussion, I want to ask each of you, and we can bounce this around, there's no formal structure to it. How did each of you begin your careers in this industry? And Sarah, maybe we start there, because you mentioned that you're not a graphic designer, and that's kind of the focus of this discussion, mm-hmm. is that it's an umbrella of all creative. So how did you guys get started?
I heard they had great pizza here, so that's why I'm here. I would say my career path is definitely non-traditional in the creative industry. I wouldn't necessarily characterize myself as a creative the way we are discussing it in today. What you are all going through school and being trained for isn't at all what I went through school for. You mentioned I was a psychology major, but I guess why I found myself where I am, which is, you know, managing an agency and overseeing the creative strategy and integration of communication strategy into creative is more why I'm here. So the fact that career paths can be very, very diverse depending on where you start, I'm sort of an example of that, where I'm not traditionally trained in the creative sense of it, but I found my home in the creative industries, and I'm a huge advocate for it. I'm inspired by and see value in and contribute to creativity every day, and yet my role isn't quite as traditional or traditionally defined as the rest of the folks on this panel. So I think that that's probably part of it. It really is a winding path for me, but I think the creativity that I draw from in my training, which was actually science and pre-med and psychology and research, has more to do with the problem solving of creativity and finding outcomes or possible outcomes where they aren't as obvious to other people. And so the piece that I bring from my training to marketing communications side of creativity is the human behavior part of it. So I'm kind of fascinated by how people behave, why they behave the way they do, and therefore I seek behavioral patterns and empathy as a source of inspiration for potentially creative solutions and products for them. Hopefully that helps.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks, Sarah. Dan, we're making eye contact.
Sure. Well, first I'm going to apologize because I tend to swear when I get excited, and I get excited when I talk about design. So sorry if I go there. My path as well in the creative industry is very non-traditional. My background is in architecture. I have a degree in architecture. And the reason that is because when I was young, I didn't actually realize that graphic design, visual design was a viable career path. It just wasn't something that I was aware of. I was a child of the 80s, late 80s, that is. I don't have hair. I'm not dating myself that much, but I was surrounded, and I grew up in board sport or skateboard and snowboard culture. And it excited me. This culture was highly visual, and to me, that was just stuff that people did. It just manifested somehow out of the culture. And I didn't realize that there were actually trained, talented folks behind how all that stuff comes to life. What I saw on TV, what I saw in a magazine, it kind of came out of the ether. And so, but I've always been fascinated by creation and creating things. And I saw an architect, there's these famous architects, and that was a way to actually have a creative path through life. So I pursued architecture, but when I was in college, I literally, the cinematic archetype of like the cartoon character walking up to the help wanted sign and taking it off the window and going inside to get the job, that's kind of how I stumbled into the visual design profession. I took a job second shift when I was in college as a proofer at a prepress shop, which really ends with the back end of creative. And I walked into this job working second shift while I pursued my studies, and I was surrounded by all these graphic designs, and I just fell in love and realized that, holy there it goes. This is a profession. This is viable. I could actually do something like this. So while I finished my studies, I started doing graphic and web design. And by the time I finished my degree, I was already a practicing graphic designer and chose to really take that path professionally. So that's how I stumbled in. And I think to your point, the paths within the creative professions are myriad, and you'll find people in the profession with backgrounds from everything from psychology to, you know, people who are scientists, who are non-typical, and creativity is something you stumble into. And that's how I got here, I guess.
Great. Xavier?
For me, I don't know how far back to go, but I've always been into art and into drawing and all those things. And I've been fairly good at it, or other people told me I was. And then somewhere in middle school, I had an art teacher kind of pull me to the side and say, hey, there's these classes downtown at this institute, the Milwaukee Institute of Art and Design. They have pre-college classes there. You should go and continue your art education outside of public school and, you know, strengthen it and get it better, because I think you might have some type of future in it. So I said, okay, that's cool. I get to draw more. And I started going to pre-college. And when I was in pre-college, I ran into an instructor by the name of Bill Kaminsky, and I took my first graphic design class. And going through that class let me know that, as you said before, that this is a real career viable option. Like, this is what some people do with their lives. And up until then, I had just imagined that I wanted to be an engineer because I was good at math. And I'm like 13 years old at this point, just to put it in perspective. But that was the first time I ever thought about going into graphic design seriously. And then, so I didn't have any money to go to school, so I kept going to pre-college in order to beef up my portfolio so I could get a scholarship. And I went to MIAD, 4 years there, got a BFA in communication design. And while I was there, I was blessed to get an internship with Kohl's doing graphic design. And then they offered me a job before I went into my senior year. So senior year, I had a job already waiting for me when I graduated. But what that meant for me is that I could do whatever I really wanted to do for my thesis. And I had always had like this affinity for music and for movies and for specifically like title sequences. So what I did with my thesis was I decided I'm going to make a completely animated 3D music video all by myself in like 2 months. And I realized that that was impossible. But I was still able to walk away with a pretty neat little project, but a new understanding of the things that I wanted to do with my life. So after that, I worked at Kohl's I told myself I was going to work there for 2 years. I made it to a year in about 8 months or something like that before I walked away from that situation so that I could pursue doing motion graphics, doing music video work, and other animations. So I'm going to be doing like my first fully animated music video now, 4 years after I tried in college. But, you know, sometimes you need to grow a little bit and learn and get some perspective. But that's been the gist of my career path so far.
Great. Nick?
I'd say that if I had to sum up kind of what I do and how I got here and why I'm doing it, I'd kick it all the way back to when I was a kid and think about the environment I grew up in. It was a constant blending of art and commerce. I had a mother that was a jewelry designer, and I had a father that was a business manager. So I think that's naturally what I ended up constantly struggling with until I decided to finally embrace both of them. For instance, making sculptures in the bathroom out of toilet paper as a child, and my father, instead of getting frustrated, putting me into an art class. You know, so it's kind of constantly taking that kind of passion and just kind of raw idea and consolidating it and putting it in a frame. I would always think of my mother would encourage me to paint, and my dad would always make sure it lands on the canvas, kind of a thing. So I started to not realize that I would constantly struggle with that. For instance, going into college, I had a scholarship to MIAD for design and art, and I was taking piano lessons from a professor at UWM already, so I kind of had an in at both. And then I started to kind of think of the life that I wanted, like an island. Like, if you don't bring it there, you're not going to find it there, kind of a concept. And so I just decided to go to both. And that was not an easy decision, but it forced me to have a conviction and commit to the decisions that I make, and kind of carry that on through the other endeavors in my life. For instance, wanting to being in design and finally finding animation was a consolidation of the UWM and MIAD experiences. It was taking the art and the music and putting them together. I constantly struggled with which route I wanted to go, and then, applying the island concept, I just figured, well, I'll put them both together, and found animation was a great way for me to consolidate that. And then was inspired to, in working a lot of freelance animation in different studios, I just had a real strong opinion on the way that I thought it could be done better. And I think if you've got those kind of ambitions, you should pursue it. So I pursued that, and it's one of those things where the paint falling on the canvas concept, if you feel drawn to something and it's not given to you, you make it and you bring it to the island. So that's kind of been, as I grow older and into other endeavors, I'm finding that that is kind of the thing that drives me. If I get excited or passionate about something, I can't let it go. It means it's meant to be pursued. And that's kind of why the hair salon is a new endeavor. As I kind of went along, I found different things that I enjoyed, and instead of making them stay into a certain medium, why make them stay here? Why do I have to just do animation? In building Blend Studios, we did a lot of interior design, and I fell in love with that. And I ended up getting another space in Chicago because I was inspired to do more interior design, and found that the design principles of static design are similar to animation, which is similar to interior design. It's all different grammars, but the same language. So I don't see really an end to it, or a line drawn in the sand. I just kind of find it harder to describe what I do when people ask what I do, because it constantly is overflowing into these other ideals. But it's that passion for creating something. The thoughts become things. That's what inspires me. So,
excellent. Now, a couple of you touched on projects from the toilet paper rolls to various other projects you've worked on.
My greatest work.
If we look back at that spectrum of activities you've all been involved in, not just design or creative, is there one specific project that if you had to go back and relive that and that moment or that creative process or that process, what project would that be for each one of you? Any one of you.
I've got one that jumps out. So
no swearing, though.
Yeah,
no, I'm saying. Swear with
abandon.
Swear right? With vigor.
I guess for me, I have a project that stands out, which was the design of a pottery museum when I was in architecture school. It was the first project that we were given a program with some constraint, but not a lot, where I was given a lot of kind of creative freedom to explore a lot of possibilities. And it sounds like that's, as a designer, that's a great thing, but it's a huge challenge. A lot of times when you're a practicing professional, you get a brief, you understand that here's the box that you have to work with. Here's the kit of parts, here's what we need to achieve. And in some ways, that constraint is liberating in that you know where the boundaries are in some places, so how do you work within that to make something amazing? And when you take that off and you take that away, the world is your oyster, and you can kind of do whatever you want. So that was the first time where I kind of set my own limits and what I really wanted to achieve. And it was an amazing period creatively for me, where I went out and walked the site of this museum and you know, took photographs, learned about the history of the land that was on, and then created my own brief from which to work upon. And that was just a, that was kind of an amazing period for me. And I guess that's what stands out for me. And that's what really, and I get the same thing, you know, the creative process, they are, it's just different grammars. When we're talking design, design is this huge family, and there are just specific, you know, specialties that you can move into, typography or, you know, web design or motion graphics or architecture. It's all just, you know, solving creative problems, and it's the same process for art.
I just want to ask, to what level of development did you take that project, Dan?
That was a student project, so that was, you know, fully rendered but not realized. There you go.
I'll jump in because, again, this isn't a creative production process in the traditional sense, but I took a lot of art and design courses and music as I was growing up and things like this. I was surrounded by creativity, and a lot of that I think has just kind of permeated what I appreciate and what I love. And I acknowledge and have seen that others have just more talent in that area, and or I have other things that I also want to do. So I think an example of how to answer that question would be what I do now with a creative process. And I do a lot of public speaking, but in reality what I do for a living is tell stories. So whether it's a story on behalf of a client or a story to get across a concept to an audience, I think I apply a creative process to crafting the arc of that story. And for me, what I'm actually going through is saying, okay, what problem am I trying to solve? How can I imagine the many, many different solutions? And then as a result, what is this endpoint I'm trying to get to? But how do I take people along for this journey? So aside from it being, you know, a structure or a toilet paper a structure or something like that, for me, what I've built was sort of the ground up of how to get people to a different place or think a different way. And one of the first times that actually happened for me in a way that felt like it was a creative process was doing a talk for a school, you know, a college class, where it was meant to be a lecture, but it turned into a major discussion. And for me, that's really where it came together, because all the planning in the world for what I was trying to get across took place, and I was able to show that with imagery to support what I was saying. But in reality, it actually danced when people engaged in it. And that's where I got the most joy from it, because it was an exchange between people and what I was trying to do and what they needed to get from it. And it ended up being an exchange of information and energy. That sounds kind of silly, but that's really what it ended up being. So that's, I think, where it really comes together for me.
Xavier?
Shit. Sorry.
So I was trying to avoid answering this question. For me, in my process, most of the projects that I've ever embarked on, like I don't think about trying to revisit them ever, and largely in part because I don't like a lot of it after I finish it, not because it's bad, but because I feel like I could have did it better. So I tend to turn that energy into the next thing that I do. Whenever I'm working on something, I become fully immersed in it, and it becomes everything that I'm doing, I really try to focus on the journey that is creating whatever I'm creating, or that process. I recently just went out to LA and I got a chance to draw with like one of my favorite artists ever. And one of the things that he said is that people hate to admit it, but drawing is painful. And I remember my freshman drawing instructor just trying to bang it into our heads that it's about the journey, and not the drawing that you make, not the end product, but the process that you go through while you're trying to realize something and while you're trying to translate something. When you're drawing from life, you're trying to translate what your eyes see into some 2D thing or whatever, you're sculpting, you're trying to translate this idea into this 3D form. So it's all about translation. And so when I'm working, I'm trying to get these ideas out of my head into something that other people can partake of. And whenever I look back on it, I feel like, oh, like I misspoke here,
if we're talking about grammar, I misspoke here, but I said this right. So if I do it again, then I'll try to do this part better, or I'll try to articulate this a little bit differently. But I tend not to try to say, oh yeah, I really, that painting I did in 12th grade, that was either the best or the worst thing I ever experienced. And just take it and move on to the next thing and let it inform the process that I'm working with the next time I embark on something.
I would say that as the businesses that I'm running are growing, it's becoming a lot more about people. And if I think back on a project, I would want to relive so much of my career, because it was creative driven and art and music driven, was very much singular, with the exception of playing with other musicians and collaborating on larger projects. You're very much focusing on your part still, even in a collaboration. You know, what are you creating to contribute? And that's wonderful, and I've enjoyed it and built my life around it. But as I said, as these things are progressing, I'm focusing more on people. And I remember an experience that I don't think I've given enough credit to that I did, and this is kind of off the cuff, but I kind of co-created a very, very subculture group called Fun Club. And it sounds like a horrible name, but it was basically just a group of 12 to 15 people that would get together in an artist studio every Tuesday night, and we would just talk and create things, and kind of whatever happens, happens. And what it was really driven by was the first time we got together, we said the second that we feel like we have to come, we kill it. It's like the day that you feel like, oh, I gotta go to this thing, like it's done. And it lasted for like years. And everybody that came stayed there. And it was just kind of this evening thing that kept happening. And it built up to us throwing an event at a bar or restaurant in Milwaukee here. And we cultivated this concept that was all of us displaying our artwork, but something we had talked about for hours and hours and days in our many meetings was communication and connection with other people. Because you're never alone. Even if you are a solo artist or any version of that, you're still dependent on your audience. So it's constantly a communal experience, whether you think so or not. You know, it always is affecting somebody more than you. So it's about the people. So we decided to, how do we create an event where everybody knows it's about them? It's not about the art. It's about how the people react to the art. It's about the people, people, people. So our idea was, what if we all wear skin-colored unitards? And the idea was to break down the social barrier of somebody feeling intimidated to come up and talk to you and something like that. And I have to be completely honest, I've never been to an event that's been more socially open, because here 15 people that are presenting work are walking around looking like they're naked, and some of us had belts on, and it looked weirder to just be wearing a belt or something. And what it created was this approachability, because then it became a thing, and everyone in the room, and it was a room packed with people, and it would give them the in to come up to you and say, what's going on here? Or you could go up to them, and you've already got nothing to lose because you're already naked, kind of. So you might as well just go up and start talking to people. And we made so many lifelong friendships in that random night that it taught me that you never know who's in a room and who's around you that's going to bring something to your life. And that approachability, that distance between you, is covered up by so many things that we're taught and that we think we are, that we think someone else is. And it taught me a very valuable lesson about what people bring to you, your creative process, and your life. So if I had to go back and relive something, I would relive that to try and get even more information out of that evening, because I learned so much about myself and other people and how important that is.
Is there a reunion of the Fun Club on the horizon?
It's right now.
It's right. Come on, guys.
All right, great.
Isn't that what we agreed? Sorry.
Yeah. You guys blew the cue. Let's try that again. All right, if you guys were to give we've got a spectrum of creatives here. If you were to give two or three bits of golden advice to those creatives who are about to embark on these upstart careers, what would those couple things be? Reflecting back on maybe roadblocks or things you ran into, what might give these folks an advantage somehow?
I have one. Never force yourself into a specific endpoint. If you think that there's a place that you're trying to get to, or there's a definition of the job, or arriving, or having made it, guaranteed, if you're not questioning about what you could do differently or more or next, you start losing your creative ability, right? So it's kind of a process of reinvention of self, even though you're not going backwards and starting over. You're building on everything that you've done before. So just picture it like a journey, like into this horizon, and we all know that the earth isn't flat, I think. So it doesn't end, but the horizon continues getting that much further out. So that'd be one.
Is this pertaining to being in school specifically?
No, I think
advice?
But I think since we're on the beginning of the preview of the portfolios, many of these students are going to be leaving here, and they've got their goods, their skill sets, their passions. What advice might you give them? And again, the range of disciplines here is pretty wide. So
yeah, it's broad stroke.
General
advice.
Yeah, make no presumption.
I would say, and this is a personal opinion, but I would say I've definitely been on the side of the fence where I felt like I work for the school in terms of I'm achieving grades and I need their approval and I'm listening to the curriculum and things like that. But my advice would be to remember that the school works for you. It's their job to get you somewhere. So take advantage of everything that they have to offer, and it's your job to be demanding of yourself and demanding of them, and not just lay back and let them tell you and delegate what you're supposed to do. It's your career and it's your life, and that's the only reason why you're here. So I would switch that paradigm and put the conviction on yourself and what you want to do with your life, and think about everything that comes after. I remember a specific experience where I had challenged a professor at MIAD in terms of what I was going to present for my portfolio. I wanted to do something that the school didn't offer, and that was video. They didn't have it at the time. And the professor said, I advise you not to, and your video's not that good. So it made me have the conviction to say, no, I'm going to, because this is what I want to do. So that professor forced me to make it about me and show why I should do it. I ended up convincing her, and it won Best of Show, and that professor hired me for professional work later on. So push the parameters and push the boundaries, because you don't know what you can do, but only you can really find that out. Don't expect the school to be the only thing that brings it out of you.
I guess it's my turn. So I'll say two things. Focusing on coming out of school and succeeding professionally, one thing that I've always said is that if you, as far as money is concerned, if you want to increase your net worth, you should increase your network. So network, get out, meet people, talk to people, and then follow up with people, especially anyone who has a big network, because you'll find work through people. You'll find jobs through people, because somebody will know somebody who needs somebody to do something. And that's how it works a lot. And make sure that you follow up with people that you do meet and you do network and connect with, because you could be passing by so many, exactly what Nick was saying before, in that room when he met so many lifelong friends. You never know who's in the room with you and what you might have to offer them and what they might have to offer you. Another thing on the creative side of things is understand that there's nothing new under the sun. So I think Picasso said, great artists steal. steal less from more people. So what's new is the way that you combine different stimuli. The way that you combine different things that have already been done is how you can create something that's new, something that's different, something that's innovative. So broaden your horizons on the things that you take in so that you can more naturally begin to perform different alchemies and put different things together that seem to be more original. And then that'll help you creatively stand out from everyone else who is riding the wave of whatever trend is popular, because people are looking for, there are two different types of people. There are people who want what already exists, and there are people who want something new, different, and groundbreaking. And you want to be on this side of the fence just because it's way cooler and more fun. So.
Great, thanks. Dan?
I guess I got maybe two pieces of advice. One is to at least once earlier in your career say yes to something that absolutely terrifies you, something that you have no confidence in yourself that you could actually complete, because it's a great motivator to actually stretch yourself and deliver. I had an architect friend, not really friend, acquaintance, this old crusty German architect who lived in Chicago, who wanted to design a typeface for his architecture studio, proprietary to him. And I said, yeah, that sounds great. Yeah, no problem. And then I realized that I didn't know anything about typography and how to actually do that. But amazingly, about 4 months later, I had developed my first typeface, and I learned so much in that period. So say yes to something that terrifies you. I'd say that's a great piece of advice. And then secondly, I think, is to always be able to, as a designer, as a professional in the design field, always be able to answer the question why. Why did you do the work that you did? And because I think design is intent. It is what separates design from, say, art, where art's this thing that kind of asks questions. Design answers it. It's like, design is this point of view that's unique to you. As a design professional, that's what you're being paid for, is your point of view. It's the opposite of that is arbitrariness. Why did you make that decision? Oh, I thought it looked cool. I thought that. No, why? Why did you make that decision? And that's what you get paid for as a professional, is to have the answer to that question. If you can do that, the sky's the limit as far as your career. And if you can explain that, that's what I think separates a craftsperson from someone who can move into more of, a business role almost, and be able to kind of take that and sell the vision and work at a professional level. Being able to answer that, I think, is key in design field.
Great, thank you.
Can I add a second one? As you guys were all talking, it occurred to me. I'm like, okay, so I can't really give design advice, and I'm not, because I don't have that insight, and I don't even have any of the training you guys have in that way. And yet I work with people like you folks all the time, and I'm inspired by it. One thing that I've learned sort of in the process of working with people who have design training and an amazing skill for creating something that didn't exist before, is that I needed to understand the value that I brought to that table while also understanding the value that they brought. So the small lesson kind of comes from this story example, and I don't know if anyone else here on the panel might have been here when this particular conversation occurred, but there was a heated debate that I once had with a colleague, where this colleague put out there that designers and design is a vocation, and that sales and marketing is a job. And that made me pause for a moment, and I got very defensive internally. I immediately got defensive and was like, what an a-hole. He's completely insulting me because I'm not, and he is, and this is this, and this is that. And I took exception to it immediately. And at the same time, once we had that debate and we walked away still really, really liking each other and respecting each other, thankfully, I walked away realizing we can't do what we're doing without both of us. That actually mattered, that I acknowledged that skill and that vocation, in his terminology, that's how he saw his value, and that's how he sees the value of creation and design. And that's actually what makes him really, really good at it. right? Understanding that this is a calling for him, and that's how he sees that. But at the same time realizing that what I'm really good at and what I bring as value is also a calling, just in a different definition. So whether you design on a screen or design with toilet paper or design with human understanding or create experience because of that, we're all creating something together, and understanding each other's value means we can actually work better together and understand the role of people and the human interaction, and that's actually who we're defining or designing for, and knowing who you're designing for and why all kind of comes together in that same way. So that was a moment of self-realization and humility and also self-valuation for me.
Great, thanks. Nick, you'll forever regret bringing up the toilet paper story.
I knew it
when I did it.
I think it's a beautiful example, right?
Yeah.
Genuine.
I think it's beautiful.
Toilet paper giraffe.
Genuine mistake. Anyway,
I said it was my best work, still.
And you still stand by that?
Yeah.
Do you still have it? That's what I want to know.
No, but I can definitely recreate it.
Yeah. All right. Well, as we consider creative pathways, and we've looked at where you've come from, so to speak, if we consider where you are going, where do each of you see your greatest challenges in any facet of what you do or what you may be doing in the future? Near future, distant future? Answering this question is not one of those scripts.
I'll answer why. I think for me, I've been doing what I do for almost two decades now, and it's become second nature what I do, and it's a professional pursuit, and what I struggle with on a daily basis is how to design a life, and it's a design a life that I think you were talking about. How do you separate the different things that you touch on a day-to-day basis, and I struggle with the same thing, where I approach life from this point of view. Maybe it's a vocation.
That's right. I've got a job.
It's a calling.
You're talking about your individual life.
Yeah, and I'm raising a family and the land I live on and the relationships I have. I look at the husband and wife team of Charles and Ray Ames as a model of how to live a designed life. And I don't mean that in some sort of theoretical European, elitist way, Mies van der Rohe in a white tower talking about design, I mean really, how do you design a life? How do you interact with your life in a way that that brings meaning and has, and you're designing that path ahead of yourself? That's what I deal with on a daily basis. And you find those walls between what you do professionally and what you do personally breaking down. And it's also a little scary because a lot of the stuff I want to be doing with my life doesn't have a paycheck attached to it. So so how do you carve the time out to do that and still balance everything else you need to kind of make your way in the world? And so there are people that can do it. They're more artists than designers that I think do it, if you're thinking classically. But I guess that's where my challenges lie.
I struggle with work-life balance. Work is my life, so I don't have a good balance. It's something that, because I'm an entrepreneur too, so it's this weird place where, like, I wake up, roll out of bed, and for years I'll wake up, roll out of bed and do work, and then I'll just keep doing work, and then I'll eat lunch, and then keep doing work, and then go see somebody or drive somewhere, and then do work, and then fall asleep. And that would be like my everyday. And I think there's a perceived challenge. Like, people always ask me, like, oh, how do you do that? How do you work all the time? I could never do that. But like what you were touching on before, it's become like the second nature. It's become a part of who I am and what my life is. But there's so oftentimes a recognition or a point that I come to, and I'm just like, hey man, I haven't like thrown a football in a while, you know, I need to go to Madison and see my little brother, you know, stuff like that. So that's one of the biggest things that I've struggled with when it comes to stuff. But
are you concerned that as you advance and maybe get a family or your life becomes more more involved, that the structure of that work-life activity becomes, well, creates a conflict?
I'm not too concerned, because if you do it right, there's a phrase that entrepreneurs spend a few years of their life like no one else will in order to spend the rest of their life like no one else can. So if you do it right, okay, it's tough. You don't know how long it's going to be tough. Might be a few years, might be a decade. But if you're doing it right, then you get to just check in at work and just say, hey, everybody, how's it going? I like that idea. I don't like this idea. Don't ask me why, because I'm the boss. But but I'll tell you
why.
Oh,
is that how it works?
Can I work for you?
And then you know, you go home or you go hang out with that family. But it's all about, you know, trying to get to the place that you want to get to. Thinking about things as an island and what do you want to bring to it. I know that I want to get to this particular place, and I don't know any way to get there other than building the road, you know, and continually meeting people along the way, looking and searching for mentors that can help instruct you on how to build that road so that you don't have to build it five times over, but, you know, build it straight on through. So I'm not too worried about, like, the longevity of the whole situation. It's just kind of like, I do this work now so I can be in a different place later, but be in the place that I really want to be and have that fulfilling life. So, yeah.
Well, I'll jump next. I'm inspired by the last two comments, Dan and Xavier. I would agree. And I'm looking here at the professional pathways for the creative, and I think that's kind of what this is all about. I kind of honed in here on a question, like, what is your pathway as a creative? And I think, I mean, Dan said it great about, you know, his life being designed, and Xavier said it great about his work being out of balance from his life, but I see it as, like, it makes me think of what my mentor said to me once, because he kind of did a lot of things as well, and it was hard to say, oh, he did this, and I was obviously super intrigued by that because I was kind of starting to go that direction. And I remember he said, I try to make my life like a work of art. You know, it's the same thing as designing your life. It's essentially whatever you're called to, whatever you're drawn towards, you know, like you're meant to do that. You're resonating with that. You need to pursue it. I always thought of it as, like, if I'm thinking about it that much and I'm called to it that much, then I already have enough energy to make it successful, versus waking up and somebody saying, oh, you've got to do this now. You just start thinking about it within that moment. But if you've already been thinking it and feeling it, you're already more prepared than the next person. So for me, I guess the next step, if I had to give a literal answer, I would probably say, I think maybe pursuing interior design long-term, because there's a couple places already that I've done, and I'm really responding to people and employees and things like that a lot and learning how to work with them. So I find it really fascinating how people interact with a space. So that's kind of a curtain kick that I'm on. It kind of merges the two.
Both residential, commercial, is there a preference?
Not really. Everything's been commercial so far. You know, and I'm
human
not
space.
Human space. Yeah, you know, there's a really cool place I went to in London called Sketch, and it really inspired me. When you walk in, it's a cafe in the kind of, I can't remember the area of London that it's in. I apologize, but it's like a constantly rotating, changing interior design. And when I was there, the particular form that it was in was, you walk into the front of the cafe and it's all really decadent and Marie Antoinette, and you sit on the floor that was kind of Indian style with lots of pillows, and the walls were full of cages with TV screens in them of birds on them. And I just fell in love with that. And then I asked to go to the bathroom, and they said, yeah, go through that door. And I went through the door, and it was a hallway. And all the furniture that you're supposed to sit on were these couches, these massive white canvases, and the furniture was pushed out through the canvas. So you sat on a couch that was the canvas from the painting. And then you had to go through that into a ballroom, this massive ballroom that's empty with animal sounds playing. And then it's you go through that into this big white room with these life-size eggs, and you open the door and you go in the egg. the light turns on the inside, so people see your silhouette outside the egg. So you're like this incubating pooping thing. And in the egg, there's sounds of children laughing. I don't know.
So plan ahead when you have to go to the bathroom in London.
Yeah. What's that?
Is it plan ahead when you have to go to the bathroom in London?
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And you know, it was kind of wonky, but it was beautifully designed. I mean, it was every part of it was gorgeous, but it was just odd and unique. And it was one of those things where nobody said this has to be like this. It just knocked down all these barriers and walls of what something is supposed to be. And I just found that it made me just constantly, my stream of consciousness kept on asking why and coming up with my own answers, which in turn was making me more creative without even trying or thinking about it. And I think that just kind of really honed in on like the creative pathway, you know, like keep yourself asking why, everybody's kind of honing in over here, like, you know, keep yourself on your toes, don't get too comfortable, don't sit back, because I think that's when you start to grow old. And I don't think age is a number. I think it's a state of mind.
Great, thanks. I'm going to ask one more question, and then I'm going to turn it over to the folks out here. I'm sure there's other better questions possibly than I've been asking thus far. What areas do you as individuals see as far as being holding the greatest potential, either technological or just as an artist, as a creative, in what you do, either professionally or just in your own personal endeavors, what holds the greatest potential for you?
Like as a medium or
It could be technological, could be a medium, could be growth for folks out here. Where might they look as far as a pathway? Where's the greatest areas for growth potential creatively?
Well, I'm highly involved in the digital community and how things are created that way. But so I'm by no means a social media specialist, but I would say there's definitely, I'm sure everyone's, this is no surprise, but there's a massive occurrence happening with digital communication, you know, Facebook, Twitter, explosion. If you think about how long those platforms have been around and how many new ones are popping up, it's insanely exponential, and it's not going to stop because it's like I was saying before, it's all about people, it's all about connection, and it's getting more and more important and crucial, and it's this new frontier, you know, being able to talk to people on the other side of the planet instantly through literally hundreds of different formats. It's not going to change. It's just going to continue to grow. So I would say just being involved in being on the edge of digital communication in general. That's definitely where things are going to continue to grow and focus. And that's what I think.
Yeah. Dan?
I would say, too, that there's a huge opportunity in knowing how to collaborate well. I think as designers individually or as an organization that you might work for, there's only so much that you can do as an individual or organization. And if you look outside of that, it might be collaborating with a partner or a partner's organization or another artist, another creative type, or another discipline. I think of Janet Eckelman. She's an artist who does these huge sculptures that are suspended over cities. They're these kind of giant fishnet style sculptures and installations, and they're huge. They're 700 feet by 700 feet suspended from buildings. She just did one in Vancouver, and normally her pieces are static in the sense that they're just something to look at and blow in the wind and walk under, and they're amazing in their own right. But she just collaborated with the Google Idea Lab, where basically Google created an app where when you go to this sculpture, you can, when you're within range, you can actually paint. You get an outline of the sculpture on your phone, and you can paint with light with these projectors that go on this 700-foot piece. And so you've got this whole community of people that are out to look at the sculpture that are interacting with the piece and making it something more than what it was. And, you know, both Google and both Janet are amazing organizations or artists in their own rights, but together they created something that you couldn't have imagined otherwise. And so, to me, I think there's a lot of opportunity there in combining disciplines and approaches.
Great. Great, thanks. Xavier?
You are looking at me.
Well,
okay.
Sarah's turning. Sarah's okay. Not making eye contact.
I'd say, well, I'd give this a bit of advice that if the students are looking for an area of potential to focus on, it would be to focus on their own potential and to try to understand how big and how limitless it really is, no matter what anybody has ever informed you of beforehand or what you have thought of previously. Just know that it is nearly boundless. If you take a look back through history at all the important figures and you think about a lot of the meager places that they come from and what they were able to evolve to, just understand that there's nothing different between them and you, except for understanding the open-endedness of this journey that is your life. So if you feel like it's real that you can make an art project with Google, then you can focus your efforts on making it real, as opposed to seeing it as some kind of pipe dream or something. Oh, I'd love to do that. And then, because if you think about it as, oh, I'd love to do that, 20 years from now, you'll still, oh, I'd love to do that, instead of I've done that. If you feel like, I can do that, how do I do that? Let's see who I need to talk to in order to make that real. What channels and what processes do I need to go through? How do I need to prepare myself to grow into that position where I could solicit Google or have Google solicit me in order to make these things happen? It's just about having a focus and understanding that if you put your efforts towards it, you can make it happen. It's just about how hard do you want to work to get there.
Right. Thanks. Sarah.
So I started a company in 2009 and left a paying job to do it, to do something that didn't exist when I was in college. I think I'm the oldest one up here, maybe. I started an agency to work on social media strategy and form, you know, a communications approach that pretty much the year before people weren't doing. And it was confusing and nobody knew what was going to happen, and I certainly didn't know what was going to happen. But ultimately the point I'm making is, guaranteed 10 years from now there's going to be an opportunity and an emergence of a new technology or a new form of communicating or connecting with people that might not even exist today. And really the skill that you have to have there isn't simply having done a graphic design class or a coding class or any of those things. You need to use your skill of adaptability and observation and apply in whatever way you think makes the most sense a solution to it, and bring that either to your own business or your employer or your life or a project that you're working on in order to be a part of the innovation rather than on the other end of it. So I don't think that rate of change is going to slow down. I think it's going to increase. And as a result, I think that really is one of the skills that you don't necessarily learn in a book, but you need to pick up as you keep going and then actually use that. So while I remember the day I graduated from Madison and I was thinking, all right, I've got my degree in psychology. I have no job. I have to move in with my parents for 3 months and pay them rent. I paid them rent to not want to live there. That was pretty awesome. But you know, it's kind of, what was the possibility? What did I think I was going to do? I didn't have a specific psychology plan, no more than I did in 2007 anticipate that 2009 I was going to start a company, right? So it really is about taking experience and observation and being present in your environment where you're working and using those skills to figure out how you can actually take your unique offering and apply it in any way. That's what I would say. So what's the possibility in the future for what your skills are today? You don't know, and I don't know, but you will know if you're paying enough attention.
Great, excellent. Questions, I'm gonna turn it over to you guys. I'm sure have questions.
So many questions.
Not all at the same time, you guys, gosh.
I have more questions.
I heard that you should be a jack of all trades and a master of one. I forgot who said that now. I really want to give them credit. But companies like versatile people because then they don't have to hire 3 and 4 people who have different specialties. But you really still want to be able to pigeonhole one thing. Well, don't become pigeonholed on one thing, but have one thing that you feel like you do better than most anybody else, or that you feel you do very, very, very well, and then continue to work on building other skill sets around that that help build that particular skill up. I don't know.
Yeah, I think, too, you see some job descriptions sometimes, and I'm involved a lot in writing those and interviewing folks, and they're just very unrealistic. You know, they're asking for someone that can set a strategy do a design concept and shoot the video and edit it and then manage the social media community and then beyond that we need some help in accounting too. You know, it's like it's these wide and it is that thing where they're looking for someone to kind of solve everything through one, and it's not realistic. So I think, you know, and I agree with this idea of being a jack of all trades and a master of one, and that one thing you master can change throughout your career too. A lot of that depends on where the market need is and also where your interest is, whether that's a salon or that's interior decorating or if that's moving into motion design or moving into web design. That's the one interesting thing about this profession, is that you do have the ability to move, and as you start to practice as a designer, you have the ability to, in time, take on that new skill set that you didn't have. And so it's a little challenging, I think, in that interview when they have that bullet list of here's everything you need to do, you know. The reality is no one's actually going to fit that criteria, and if they do, they're a master of none, and they're probably not going to do any of those things really, really well. So sell yourself on the strengths that you have on that list, and then just dance around the ones that you don't.
Yeah, I would go along with that and just add to it, essentially, like, people only know what you present to them, and of course you can talk your way through and they can give you an opportunity, but if you are okay or pretty good at lots of things, there's the assumption that that's might be the best you can do. If you're incredible at one thing, there is an assumption that if they take you and put you on this other thing, you'll do just as well, because it's not necessarily that maybe you're a fantastic designer, but you have no ideas. You know, if you're an amazing designer and you also want to be an idea person, if you're that good at design, the potential that you have is, you know, can be assumed. And I think people are going to take you a lot more seriously if you're really, really good at something, because obviously you can learn a new thing anytime.
Yeah, that idea there is the process. If you have a really good process and you can show that you can be really good at one thing, then it should be able to translate to something else. You might have a learning curve, but you could get good at it too.
I'm going to talk about the other side of the coin, which is the soft skill side of getting hired and staying employed. Going back to the vocation idea, you guys are graduating with a very specific set of skills, right? And want to apply those skills right away as much as you can, right? You want to get paid for doing what you love to do and what you are good at and what you've been trained to do. But a job doesn't stay the same job as you move through it, right? So as an employer of people with many different skills, and you guys can speak to this too, I'm sure, we don't just hire a skill, we hire a person. We want to know what it's like to work with you and how you work with others, how you handle pressure, how you direct others when you have to work with them, even if you're not in charge of them, how confident you are and able to explain the why you did what you did. And that's stuff that you don't necessarily learn in a class, but pick up in life. And that's a very important piece to bring to the interview or portfolio discussion that you're having, because that's really what we're investing in, is we're investing in a person who, if you can learn the skill that you were hired to do, we will believe that you can do other skills too, but we don't just need you to show up and do that one thing every day. We also need you to participate and think of new things and help us expand our business or our outcome or our project or whatever it is in terms of the path. So don't forget that you're a whole package, and the rest of that package is actually what keeps you there. Your portfolio might get you there in the first place, but it doesn't stop there.
I don't have a degree in graphic design. and I think talent comes from anywhere. I think if you have the skill set, there are pathways into this profession. I had an amazing, talented kid from Skokie, Illinois, shoot me a portfolio out of the blue, and it blew my mind. It was amazing. He was a illustrator and did a lot of identity logo design. And it just amazed me. And I brought him in, and but he couldn't, it got him that far. I think to your point on the soft skill side, it was now that he was there, he wasn't very communicative, and I couldn't actually imagine myself working with him on a daily basis, but amazing talent. And so I think if you, and self-taught, completely self-taught, and there, it, had he had that little bit of soft skill where I could imagine working with him, he'd be working for me today. So I don't know, to me, there's talent, and there's I do think there are benefits to a wide ranged, broad-based education, but sometimes there's talent that is just kind of raw talent that can get you in the door and get you a position. But it takes work, and this kid had been teaching himself since about eighth grade, but it was, to me, I hold no degrees are, while it proves that you've done the work, to me, it's not the only thing that matters. It's mm-hmm. the work and the person.
I'd add something Blend Studios has been doing. As you know, Blend Studios were the full post-production facility working with through editing, motion graphics, design, and we also do production. We've recently expanded our horizons to work with people all over the world. We have people working for us in England and Spain currently, LA, New York, and Chicago. And I would say that there's a whole world out there that you can tap into through the use of, like I was saying, social media, video chatting, video Skyping, the use of Dropbox. Things can be anywhere at any time, all the time. And I can testify that is incredible that you can work with somebody on the other side of the planet and like they're in the same room with you. So, there's two ways to look at this that I'm going to illustrate. One, don't look at just your local community as being the only outlet or outsource for you to get work from. And also, in having work with people all over the place and also living mostly in Chicago right now, Milwaukee is a fantastic place to be one of the best at something. You can really be really well known here locally to be an amazing designer or thinker or production and producer. It's really possible, and it's amazing how possible. I've seen designers just shoot up the ladder so quickly here locally. So there's that's one opportunity that you guys definitely have in this city. It's very it is a medium to small size city, and it's very supportive. So, you know, take advantage of that, and also take advantage of the communication to get work anywhere in the world. It is possible. It's pretty amazing.
Great. Well, I think we'll take one more question. Chuy, your question is, what advice can, was this to Dan directly? To all the panelists? Advice about working in a collaborative group and dealing with egos.
Oh.
Yeah.
Swearing, Dan?
Yeah, a lot of swearing.
Do you want to go first, Dan?
Yeah. I talked earlier about intent and designers being intentional people. And I think, especially when you're working, you're collaborating with someone who has a strong point of view, people read that as a strong ego. And really what that is a strong informed approach to kind of this professional practice. And I think as long as, again, I'm back to that idea of why, it's not an arbitrary thing. Contrary to you just wanting to say, that's the way it goes. That comes out of earned respect, and that comes out of like knowing what it is that you work with. So egos, I think some things that are seen as egos aren't really egos, but it's a professional experience that's kind of speaking. At times there are egos that clash though too. I think I look back at me as a young designer, and I didn't answer why. I just said it was arbitrary. I like it. It's something that I built, and I think it's something that's a hard lesson as a designer starting off. Is when you've worked so hard on something, you've got this baby that you've brought into the world, and it's killed, either by a client, by a coworker, by a lack of a budget, whatever it is, that's going to happen. And really quickly, you learn that's okay, and that you'll make it, and there'll be more chances. So that collaboration and the ego side of it, I think you kind of fall into it. You learn to understand if that's someone's personal hang up or if it's actually what's right for the project or for the client that you're working with.
Yeah, to do, and that was just a joke. I don't get the why, but basically, what I would advise, like whenever I'm having a discussion with someone. And I'm saying discussion, but really an argument. And you feel like you as a person, you have to learn how to identify, like what you said, what's personal and what's not personal. And you never don't just start telling people, you just think that because this, that, and the other. Start to ask questions with objective answers and remove the personal bits from whatever it is you're doing or whatever it's you're working on and focus on making your conversations productive and centered around objective tasks and objects so that people can for themselves begin to realize, well, how much of my idea really is true to form and how much of it is my own opinion. And basically, hopefully through that process, either that person realizes that they are bringing baggage to this table or they don't realize it, and you realize that you don't want to work with them anymore. So,
I'm going to bring an objective opinion to this because I did not always work in the agency side of things, and I didn't always work in marketing. One of the jobs I've had that I really, really enjoyed it was in marketing as a marketer for a mergers and acquisitions company. Egos are not only in the creative profession. They exist everywhere. We all have one, technically. The question is, what do we do with it? And how do we interact with people? And whether we call big egos simply, an expression of an opinion or simply bad behavior, we have to decide how we're going to deal with that, right? We have a choice of how we're going to interact with someone, whether they're our superiors or subordinates, whether it's opinion or insecurity. And that comes with experience, of course, but it also comes with confidence in what you know and what you're good at. And knowing when to take on a battle and when to walk away. It's sort of like Kenny Rogers and No One to Hold Him and No One to Fold Him. Sorry, not everyone has necessarily heard that song. But it really does come down to people. And that was what we were all kind of getting back to, or what we were talking about earlier. That soft skill of navigating people and personalities really comes down to understanding the motivation. What do you guys have in common? If you're working on something and you're collaborating on a project together, the goal is to succeed in the project, not to get your idea heard louder or necessarily to win. If the collaboration is truly a collaboration, it's going to take pieces of each person's perspective, and you have to kind of give a little and take a little and give a little and take a little. So it does come with experience, but it also comes with trying to be empathetic to the other person's position and maybe even calling them out when their behavior is not appropriate.
Yeah, I think I'm going to agree with everyone up here. Amazing
Thank
ideas,
you.
Yeah. Maybe just try to offer a different angle of the same idea, or say it a different way. But a company is most successful when it works as a team. And if you're going to work with or for a company, you're in a flock of birds. And if somebody's doing better than you, you know, that's amazing and that's fantastic. And you should go along with them and support that and help them, because that's going to help you. You know, you're going to sit in the drag, and you're going to go faster than you would if you were by yourself, because you're obviously, maybe you're not the bird that's leading, and you're going to get better and you're going to grow, and everyone grows together. And also to stay positive. It sounds really silly and super hippie, but really, like, in any environment, if you can stay extremely positive, even if somebody has an ego, which I think we're all implying that they're being really negative and have a shitty attitude or something, it's really good if you can just, like, completely combat that with positivity, because what's going to happen is they're going to just hear their ego bouncing off the walls and eventually hear themselves coming back to themselves, and it's just a matter of time before they realize that they might be the problem. But if you give them the reasons and excuses to be upset with you, if you combat, they're just going to constantly deflect all of that negativity on you, because you're giving it right back. So if you stay completely positive, it's incredible to see what it does. And I work with a growing number of people, and as time goes on, and it's amazing to see, literally, especially if you can be the difference. When you walk into a room and you're happy and you're positive, even if you're just it's really like gunning for somebody, if you walk into a room, it is amazing when you're paying attention to it to see how that kind of an idea and that energy really does spread around other people. And it's a really, really powerful tool to allow yourself to be the best you can be and have everybody also respond to that positive energy and support you being better yourself.
All right, well, we're gonna wrap things up here because we've got a little 10-minute break in between heading upstairs to the portfolio reviews on the sixth floor. I wanna say a special thanks to you guys, Sara, Dan, Xavier, and Nick, for taking this time out of your day to share your perspectives with us. I can't thank you enough. And we couldn't have scripted this better.
College Place is a video library of noteworthy presentations, panel discussions, and lectures featuring guest speakers and faculty members, taped at one of the Milwaukee Area Technical College's 4 southeastern Wisconsin campuses. These are produced by students in the college's associate's degree program in television video production, in coordination with Milwaukee Public Television.